Okay, let's start our eighth lecture. Last time I've finished with some background on the Lie algebras of the Lie groups. I think I will devote one lecture on it later, and now I want to finish some tensorial formalism on the curvature tensor. But what was mentioned last time? It was mentioned that if you want to define some reasonable connection on the space psi, where psi is a function that goes from depends on n variables, and this is they are vectors in Rk, then firstly this is matrices, and these matrices should be skew symmetric actually. If, for example, your psi is invariant under the action of orthogonal group here. So just just remember that skew symmetric matrices, they are form the algebra of the group of rotations in they form the tangent space at identity of the subgroup of all orthogonal matrices, orthogonal with positive determinant, and this was proved last time. So when you have some, this is group of SON, you have identity, you want to find how does the tangent space of your manifold looks like. So you consider some very small shift of the identity, and you understand that this small shift should be skew symmetric matrix. And this is, so you understand that the tangent space for the group of orthogonal matrices at the unitary matrix is all skew symmetric matrices. Actually, this fact is useful to understand what is the dimension of SON, because the dimension of manifold, yes, is equal to dimension of its tangent space if you fix this some point, yes, some point on this manifold. So the manifold can be curved. You don't understand how it looks like globally. But if you want just to understand what the dimension of this manifold, you can consider only the tangent space. The
tangent space can be at any surface in that manifold. The point can be at any surface.
Yes, at any point. Yes, because there are some more sophisticated spaces topologically. For example, you can glue, for example, triangle and interval, yes? So this is some topological space too, but this is not a manifold, because you have some parts that have two dimensions, some parts have one dimensions. There are a lot of very ugly spaces, especially in the general topology, that you ask some reasonable question, for example, I don't know. When you ask if this some very, very reasonable condition is hold, then almost always you can construct some ugly space, some topological space that doesn't hold these conditions. So, for example, there are, I don't know, do you know this Cantor stairs? Do you know this example? Cantor stairs. No? For it means that this is funny, of course it's absolutely have no connections with our course. You have interval from 1, from 0 to 1, and you consider the following construction. You divide this interval on 2-3 parts. So here you have 1/3, 2/3, and you begin to define define a function on this interval. On that interval, you define it just like 1/2. Yes? And then with this interval and this interval, you're doing the same. So here will be 1/4 and 1/8. Yes? And so on. So you will get the function. Actually, this function will be continuous because everything is continuous. But this function, the image of this function is a discrete set on this interval. So, but still it is monotonic, it's continuous. But its image doesn't cover all the interval from 1 to 0. So there are a lot of strange examples about this. So never mind. So if you want to understand the dimension of your manifold, you can construct its the manifold is very, very good spaces from the topological point of view. So you can construct its tangent space, and if it looks like much easier because the tangent space is a vector space always. And you can understand the dimension of its tangent space and they will coincide because you can think of tangent space as some kind of linearization of your manifold in a point. Or probably you say trivialization, yes, in physics, no? Okay, but from here you understand that the tangent space for the orthogonal matrices at unit. So the unitary matrix is a point, yes, is a point on the space of all orthogonal matrices. You consider this unitary matrix as a point on this manifold. So the tangent space, this tangent space will be all skew symmetric matrices. What is the dimension of all skew symmetric matrices? It is very easy to calculate. Come on. Matrix N over N. You have N here and N here. It is skew symmetric. It means that Aij equals to minus Aji. So, for example, Aii equals to what?
Zero.
So on diagonals you have zeros. Here you have some A 1, 2. So it means that here you must have minus a 1, 2. Yes. So actually you can forget about this part because it is there is 1-to-1 correspondence between this triangle and that triangle. So how many components here in that triangle? Well, how many there are all components in a square matrix? N squared, yes. So you forgot about the diagonal and divide by 2, yes? This is the dimension. Usually you write it like down this way. And this is exactly the dimension of orthogonal matrices. For example, at in our space, three-dimensional space, any orthogonal matrix from SO3 is a composition of three types of rotations. Do you know about Euler angles? No? Euler angles. So any there is a theorem. I don't want to prove it, but it is easy. That if you have some orthogonal matrix from here, it means that for any Q in SO3, there is some L is a line in R3 such that Q is a rotation around line L with some angle phi. So just to draw some geometrical picture to understand that you see that three minus 1 divided by 2 is 3. Yes, just to understand what does this 3 means from qualitative point of view. So you have some line, yes, in three-dimensional space, line L. And the theorem states that any orthogonal matrix is a rotation over this sum line L with angle phi, yes? So this is kind of statement. So you can count how many dimensions do you have. The line is have its vector, yes? The vector of the line. So it has some coordinates, alpha, beta, gamma. But how many degree of freedom do you have here? You can multiply this vector by some constant and it will be the same line. Yes, so actually the dimension of all lines that lies in R3 and that goes through the origin is 2. Because you can always think that some of its coordinates equals to 1. Yes, so locally you have 2 degrees of freedom if you choose a line in three-dimensional space. So, and you have angle phi. So, 2 plus 1, this is the dimension of the space of all lines. And this is the angle. So, this is 3. So, this 3, this is that 3. So, locally it looks. And the Euler angles is what is this? you can always factorize this matrix on the some kind of this, I think, cos phi 1 sine phi 1 minus sine phi 1 cos phi 1 0 0 0 0 1. Then you have some this is also phi 2, the same rotation matrix, and then phi 3. So there is some decomposition of any orthogonal matrix in the product of three simple rotations in some fixed planes in three-dimensional space. So this was done already by Euler, and I'm sure that he understands all these calculations. Okay, so this was about some rotations, and one more example about the connections is the following. It's very simple, I think. For example, that if the group that acts on the space of all psi's is U1, so G is U1, is SO2, this is just a circle, a rotation on some angle phi, for example, in the complex plane, yeah. So what does it mean? If you have some element belongs to this group, it means that it is actually have the following form. And if you have some vector psi, it's not a vector, just a complex number, then you easily understand how does this group acts on the complex numbers. They just it just rotates all this plane by the angle phi. So this is just simple multiplication. If you consider this action, the action of this group on this space. Okay, so this is a group, yes? This is one-dimensional group. This is a circle that lies on complex plane, and you want to understand how does the tangent space to this group looks like, because you want to understand how does the algebra of this Lie group looks like. But in this case it's absolutely trivial. You just draw the tangent line. So this is one, yes, this is one from any point of use. This is a real unit, yes, the one in real line. This is one in as a complex number, and also this is one as an element of U1, yes? So this is just e to the power of zero, yes? So you consider the tangent space for this group. This is only this line, and you see that if you consider this line as a vector space, this is just ER. Yes, you can shift this real line to the origin, and you will get vector space. This is absolutely trivial. So actually, algebra of this Lie group is real numbers multiplied by complex unit, and how does these formulas looks like in this trivial case. They are the following. So your vector psi depending on some coordinates in Rn, so I put it down here, and you should multiply it by E. What is it? Ah, no, da. E A alpha, where alpha is belonged to R. Yes. So just like this, A alpha was from the algebra of the group here. In this trivial example, this E A alpha belongs to the Lie algebra of U1, and this is the charge. Probably you know better what it is. So this is some constant that usually you have in your some calculations. So what next? You want to understand what happens when you multiply a vector by some phi of x. From physical point of view, there should be if it is invariant, so there should be some invariance under this rotation of these vectors. So it means that A alpha goes to some A alpha plus this shift, and well, eventually you get some Young-Mills fields. If I understand correctly, and Young-Mills fields, they are exactly can be interpreted as these connections that are invariant under action of some groups that acts on some observables. So, okay. Let's do some definitions. The connection is called torsion-free. Of course, when its torsion is zero. So from the point of view of Christoffel symbols, it means that Christoffel symbols are symmetrical under the permutation of these down indices. Next definition. And we remember that torsion is a tensor. So if the difference of the Christoffel symbols is a tensor, so if in some coordinate systems your torsion is zero on all manifold, it means that in any another coordinate system it is zero too. So uh, nebula is yes, you know, yes, that this is letter called nebula. Nebula is compatible with a metric J if nebula of G is zero. So actually, firstly, what how you must think about this equation. So G is a metrical tensor. It has two low indices, yes, and you can understand this as a sum tensor of type 0,3, yes, and this tensor should be vanished if you want to have some connection that is compatible with your metric. It is better to look on this equation as an equation on your nebula. So you have usually some metric on your manifold. You have a metric, and you want to define some good connection on it, connection on your manifold. And there is a theorem, one of the main theorems in this Riemannian geometry. It states that exists and there is only one torsion-free metric, torsion-free connection that is compatible with a given metric. It means that these equations on a connection is correct. So from this system of equation, you can uniquely find a solution. If you by the solution, I understand the connection. To understand this, let us understand how many parameters or how many degrees of freedom do we have in these equations. So how many Christoffel symbols do you have if you don't suppose that it is Christoffel symbols of torsion-free and compatible connection at all? How many do you have them on a n-dimensional manifold? What?
Four,
no, of course not. I mean that I, J, and K, they are indices, yes, and all of them goes from 1 to N, yes? So, you have N third and third components of all Christoffel symbols. If you don't suppose that there is some symmetries and so on, because this is can go from one to n, this from one to n, and that from one to n. So actually, in this system, it is not linear. It is not even algebraic system. It's a differential system because you have this. You have this unknowns. Yes, how many unknowns do you have here? You have n in the power in the cube, n cube, n cube unknowns here. Okay, how many equations do you have in that systems, in that system? The first part of the system, you k goes from 1 to n, so you multiply n by what? And here you have ij and ji, they are equal, yes? So exactly the number of the so for example t k I I is equal to 0. This is not equation. This equation holds trivially, right? So how many equations do you have when you fix the k indexes? Exactly, this will be the same picture as in yes. As in skew symmetric matrices. So here you have n minus 1 divided by 2. So equations in t equals 0. When you demand for t to be zero, a torsion to be zero, you have this number of equations. So, and how many equations do you have here? You have index di and jk, yes? So for any I, j, k, this equation should hold. That equation is just some short notation for that one. So you should understand that this is not one equation on some one scalar function j. There are a lot of equations here. So I goes from 1 to n. Just like k, here you multiply by n all, and here you have how many components do you have in metric? Yes, how many? G J K. How many components do you have here? Huh? No. N squared, if it would be the true if there wasn't symmetry of a metric. So you have exactly the same number, yes, but plus diagonal. In metric it's not skew symmetric, it's symmetric. So you have the same number plus diagonal. So this is actually n minus 1 divided by 2 plus n, and it is equal to n plus 1 divided by 2. And if you sum this, you will get n by 2. N minus 1 plus n plus 1. This is exactly n squared. So you see that the number of equations and the number of unknowns, they coincide. So you have as many equations as unknowns. So that system is correct. What? N cube. N multiplied by N divided by 2 multiplied by this. So here you have 2N. This is equal to N cube. So locally at least this system is correct. And of course you can guess that maybe this system is not well defined. Maybe it is possible. It is very hard to understand that the uniqueness, yes, of the system, yes, because some equations here could be dependable. You can have some degeneracy in that system. Well, it can be proved that there is no such degeneracy, and actually this formula that was given, that was proved in differential geometry, it gives the answer, it gives the solution for this equation. So that formula gives a solution for that system. And to make this formula more obvious, we should remember how does the covariant derivative of a 0-2 tensor looks like. So last time I wrote how does the covariant derivative of tensor of any type looks like, yes? And there was a big formula, but at least at this time it is useful. So if you will check that formula and will apply it exactly for the metric as a 0-2 type tensor, then you will get the following. So because you want your connection to be compatible with your metric, it means that this should be zero, yes? And if you look closely, you can understand that if you defined your Christoffel symbols using that formula and put these Christoffel symbols here, then it should, then it will be zero. Well, it is, you see, this is some combination of differentials of your metric. Here you have inverse matrix, yes? So this and this will cancel out, and this combination of these partial derivatives will all goes to zero.
G L I here.
Where? A I, yes, yes, yes. Yes, it's I. Here, yes, here I and here J. K. Mm-hmm. Okay. correct. So definition. This connection that is torsion free and compatible with a metric is called Levi-Civita connection. So if you have a metric which is not degenerate, actually it's not important whether this metric should be on a Riemannian manifold or Lorentzian or some pseudo-Riemannian manifold. Then you have unique and well-defined connection on your manifold. Do you know what's pseudo-Riemannian? Pseudo-Riemannian it means what? If you have a metric tensor, then IJ in some coordinates, at least locally, you can write down it is as an a diagonal matrix. Yes? Locally. Actually not locally, but in a point. But okay. So if all these numbers, they all are positive, then you have Riemannian metric. If you have one minus, then this is Lorentzian. So it is well known. Minus dt squared plus dx squared plus dy squared plus dz squared. Yes, this is standard Minkowski metric. And if you have more than one minuses, you call this metric pseudo-Riemannian. I don't know any application of this metric. Actually, there are, but it's this is long story. But almost all reasonable metrics, they are either Riemannian or Lorentzian. There is some applications, but they are kind of weird. It's a long story to tell how. Yes, pseudo-rotations. We will talk about this when we will describe the isometries of this Minkowski space. Okay. So, if you have a manifold with a metric, then you can define a connection. This will be unique connection. You defined it using these formulas for gamma ijk, and all is fine. Next, what you want to ask about this connection. This connection is the same as covariant derivative, and you want to ask if they are commutative. If it would be the standard partial derivatives, it would be true. But this is not a partial derivative. This they are covariant derivatives, and of course it's not true. In general, exactly the curvature describes the measure of how does this covariant derivative is not commutative. Okay, let's make a break. On some calculations. Thank you. So this first covariant derivative as a standard formula, then you apply the second covariant derivative, and this is what you will get. So I'm not sure if all the indices are okay, but you can check. Why do we have this summand? Why do we have this summand here? Actually, you see, yes, this is the, if you will forget about that, this is a standard formula for the covariant derivative along kth coordinate of vector xi. Yes, this is a standard formula. So if you would apply this covariant coordinate, it would be natural to have only these two summands. Why do we have that one? Because the question, why do we have this summand? because actually this is what? This is a 1-1 tensor, and when you apply the formula of a connection to 1-1 tensor, you exactly have these formulas, yes? Because, for example, nabla KTIJ, it equals to, I don't want to put all these indices, but this is will be the standard partial derivative plus. So 1-1, some gamma because of this up index, minus gamma because of that low index. Yes, this is from this general formula to KL type tensor. So exactly because this is the second covariant derivative, the first covariant derivative generate this new low index, we have this summand with minus. And when we will open all the brackets and regroup summands, not regroup yet. So this is equal to the following second derivative of xj xk of xi I plus Yeah. M xk minus gamma M kj dxi I of xm plus xi l d gamma I l k xj and gamma mji gamma l k m xi l minus gamma kj m gamma l m I xi l. And this was JK. So when we calculate exactly the same but with kj and subtract, no, it there may be, no, there is no mistake. You see that these second derivatives, they cancelled and we get the following. So big bracket here. L. And some additional term which should be zero. Okay, I, this is I and this is L, summation over L, okay, at least it looks like true-ish, I would say. So this is zero because it is torsion-free. This is zero summons, and this long combination of derivatives and squares of Christoffel symbols, this is exactly the components of the Riemann curvature tensor. So R I L kj is equal exactly this. So I will erase this term and this is exactly the R I L K J Xi L. So you see, this is the definition of the components of the Riemannian curvature tensor. So this was definition. What next? Next, it would be good to write the components of the Riemannian curvature tensor in more invariant way, so without mentioning the coordinates. Then if you do that, you should introduce some additional term. So let me show kj xi k eta j zeta l is equal to what does it mean? It means that, for example, what is Nabla K? It means the covariant derivative along the coordinate vector field. So if you have a kth coordinate on your manifold, yes, xk, you have a vector field that is tangent to this kth coordinate. And the covariant derivative is a derivative along this vector field. But of course, you can introduce some different vector fields that are not coincide with this coordinate. That very it rotates somehow and so on. It means actually that if you what is the difference between so any vector field can be written down as the following one. So this is coordinates of this vector field and this is di. So at any point of your manifold, you have a basis of tangent vectors fields that coincides with the derivatives along the eth coordinate. And any vector field, it can be written down as a linear combination of these vector fields, yes, where xi ith is functions on your manifold. For example, let me show you the example. Maybe it should be important. Yeah, on the plane we have coordinates x and y, and dx This is exactly the same as d1, exactly the same as d over dx. This is different notations for all the same. What does this vector field looks like? It's just this vector. Yes, so this is a shift along the x coordinate. Dy is the same, yes. But you can introduce some different vector fields. For example, the vector field that is tangent to, for example, the circles. Yes. So you have point of coordinates x and y, and how does this vector looks like in coordinates? So this is vector field. You see, at any point it is tangent to the circle. And in this point in the origin, it equals to zero. This is the zero of this vector field. You want to calculate how does this vector field should look like. It means that there is some linear combination of dx plus dy. Yes, always there is some formulas for this. So how does it looks like? You have the point x. Yes, and in this direction, okay, let's calculate more precisely. Because it is important to understand that for the following formulas. So this is point xy, this is 0, 0, and you want to write down the coordinates of this vector. Yes, this vector exactly that goes from origin to this point, it has coordinates xy, then this vector should have what coordinates? Minus y x, yes, because they are orthogonal. Yes.
No, x is this way. We are assuming x is right side. So.
Okay, let me draw. So this is 3, 2, and what coordinates will have this vector? So x will be negative, yes?
Yeah.
Minus 2, 3, because they should be orthogonal, yes? You calculate the scalar products of these two vectors, and this is zero. Okay? But this point is not fixed on our picture. This point always goes around on these circles, yes? So this is, you might consider this is the point, the tangent point, yes? And you want to find the coordinates of this vector at any tangent plane. In different points you have different tangent planes, yes? So it means that here you will have minus y, and here you have x. Okay, at any point this vector field will be looks like that. It will be tangent to the circles with this radius. Okay. So, and for example, if you want to just already to illustrate, if you want to find the solution of ordinary differential equation, how do
this is a divergent equation, right?
What?
Divergence equation.
Yes. For example, if you want to solve this type of equation, x dot equals xi. How do you usually define, how do you usually consider the equation, differential equation? It, for example, the most well-known type of differential equation is the following. What does it mean? It means that in, at point x, yes, this is point x. This is vectors, this is matrix. This is vector xy and this is 2x2 matrix. Yes. It means what? It means at point x the velocity, this is the velocity, yes, in the left hand side, is equal to some linear function on the point x. So what should be this matrix A in this case? So in this case it will be exactly what? 0 minus 1 0 x y. Yes? So you put this is exactly this is the same situation but in different notation. If you consider this vector field xi in that formula, you will get this will be exactly the same as this differential equations. And when you integrate it, yes, how does this differential equations looks like? It looks like x dot equals to minus y. Y dot equals to x. Yes, you solve it and you will get for example r cos r sine. So this is exactly these circles. Okay, so what is the difference between general vector field and coordinate vector field? The difference is that the Lie bracket, it is exactly the commutation of standard partial derivative is zero. But if you consider some general vector field, the Lie bracket, this you consider your vector field as a differential operator of order one. You consider, for example, you have function f, and what is this? You differentiate this function f from firstly in the direction of eta, then in the direction of theta. Then you subtract. Yes? So the higher orders, the second orders here and here, they cancelled, and you will get another vector field that is actually is called a Lie bracket. So in general case, this is not zero, and you should not forget about it. If you consider not only the coordinate vector fields, it is important in Riemannian geometry because almost all good vector fields, they cannot be described as a vector fields along some coordinates. Usually, if you want to have some comfortable, some suitable for some task vector fields, the basis of vector fields, they are not coordinates. And in physics, instead, you always use only coordinates, for example, in Landau-Lifshitz and so on. So this is some kind of way of writing different things. Okay, so I tried now to explain that you should add this term with this. Next, there was this plus minus, and you probably have a lot of questions about this xi eta z minus eta xi z zeta, and here you have plus or minus. There is some kind of ambiguity in all different books. For example, in that book with Misner, the three or four authors, I gave you the book in the first lecture, Misner and some others. In the first of the pages, they given notations, different notations, and they describe in what book there is one notation, and in another book there is another notation. So there is different notations in different books. So we will use plus, but sometimes minus. You should just understand that it is not important. Why? Because if you just multiply your connection by minus, yes, so here you have double action of a covariant derivative. Here you have double action of covariant derivative, and here you have only once. So this sign can be changed if you just define your connection in another way. So I just want to warn you that in different books, different sources, you might see different signs here. It doesn't important really when you begin to calculate some concrete matrix. You almost always have no possible to choose wrong sign. Okay, so this was an introduction for Riemannian curvature, and what is left to prove? Будьте здоровы. Yes, and this summand is crucial for this theorem, because if there wasn't this sign, it won't be true. You have this tensor. Yes, by the way, what the type of this tensor? The type. No, the type of the tensor. So GIJ, yes. What type does metrical tensor has? 0-2 tensor. Because it goes, it's, it maps the pair of vectors, and it goes to the scalar numbers, yes, scalars. So this is exactly the scalar product. You have two vectors, and then by multiplying them scalarly, you get a scalar. So two vectors, one scalar. What is the type of R of the Riemannian curvature? It goes from, you have 1, 2, 3 vectors, and the result will be a vector 2. Yes? So you have 3 vectors, and the result of this tensor. It is a vector 2. So actually, this is a 1, 3 tensor. So this is this is the statement of this theorem, that actually this is a tensor. And if there wasn't this summand, it won't be true, because well, you should do some calculations to check that. What calculations I would like to do here? Well, wait a second. So to prove this theorem, one should check the following. What is, I don't want to do that, because you should check a lot of things, but what is the main method to check if some object is a tensor? It is defined on some vector fields, usually, yes? And for example, if you want to check if some object is a tensor, actually it should be proved too. But if you multiply your vector field by some function, not only the some constant function, the following should be hold. So the tensor is just some objects that are linear with respect to some scalar functions. Yes? Yes. So then you might regard a tensor as an object that defines, that is defined on the some number of vector fields, and is linear with respect to the functions, not only the scalar functions, but any functions on your manifold. So this is the main criteria when you checking if some object is a tensor. This should be hold, and it is not difficult to check that this is true. For example, when you multiply vector field z by some scalar function, you exactly, what is the covariant derivative of vector along the vector field psi of scalar function f. This is simple the derivative of a function along the vector field. So this is standard. So you multiply z by f, z by f, z by f. Then you use Leibniz rule, and exactly this difference will be the same as this when you will differentiate f along this Lie bracket, and they will cancel. So it will goes there, this f. So it's not difficult to check using that criteria that Riemann tensor is really a tensor. Well, of course, it would be strange to define some object that wouldn't be a tensor, or you should check, or you should saying about this some especially. Okay, so we define this tensor, and there is some properties for this tensor. I just write them down.
If you take it dice,
Dice
having six faces.
Write down.
Six faces die. Cuboid, something kind of thing. Cuboid, dice. You play dice, you don't know?
No.
Мы играли на кубик.
Okay.
So, can you define it as a tensor? Field, a tensor object?
No. On this cubic?
Yeah, no, six faces as a tensor object.
This is very strange question. I might say. Maybe to define a tensor on the table, yes, or on the chair, it is very strange. Why do you want to define a tensor on this?
It's a real-time object, if you want to visualize a tensor.
Well,
my question is, can we consider it as a tensor object? Can we say it as an example for tensor object?
I doubt.
Okay.
If you want to consider, for example, so if you have two-dimensional surfaces, yes, maybe, but this is homeomorphic to sphere, for example. I don't.
Okay.
So when I imagine this object, I trying what I'm trying to do is to imagine what manifold it can be, to define a tensor on it. You should have some. But here you have known smoothness, maybe, I don't know, no. I never meet some tensors on some strange things. what did I want to show. Probably we will next time I will say all the symmetries. So symmetries of Riemann curvature tensor. So ILJK. In general, if there were no symmetries, actually there should be n in the power of 4 components, yes, of this tensor, but there are a lot of symmetries here. Actually there are 4 statements in that theorem. I don't have time now already, but because this construction of this tensor is quite sophisticated, you might think that many of these components, they are dependable. For example, the first symmetry is the following: I L J K minus I L K J. Because when you intertwine xi and eta, xi and eta in this formula for the curvature tensor, you get minus. This is trivial. Second one is not trivial. Well, and so on. I will write down two more properties for curvature tensor and then we'll prove them or not all of them. So, and next, yes. Next time I will introduce Ricci tensor. So what is Ricci tensor? You just consider the convolution. If you put I here, so you get the summation over the I index here, yes? And you will get the Ricci tensor. The Ricci tensor, it is symmetric tensor because of the symmetries that there is between L and K. This is symmetric tensor, and actually, for example, I didn't see this notation, Ricci tensor, in physical literature, but it has the same type as metrical tensor and the impulse energy tensor. So this is the main object that will appear in Einstein equations. Okay, let's stop.